Good morning and a warm welcome from Docplexus. Today we're here to trace the journey of one of the most celebrated endocrinologists, Dr. Ambrish Mithal. Dr. Ambrish Mithal is the chairman and head of endocrinology and diabetes division of Medanta, the multi-super specialty hospital at Gurgaon. He has been honored with the prestigious Padma Bhushan award in recognition of his distinguished service in the field of medicine. So his day usually begins at 6 a.m. with a brisk 45-minute walk in the local park. He believes in following his own advice for his patients by starting his day with exercise.
Walk is always nice, yeah. Invigorating. I wish I had more time though. always rushing even this thing. But I do give half an hour, 45 minutes actually, okay. Every day.
And what is that you listen to since you...
Contrary to what you'd expect actually, I listen to old Hindustani classical.
Okay.
So a rag takes about 40 minutes.
Yeah.
So it's a 40-minute walk. Yes. Yeah.
Family is important to Dr. Mithal. Therefore, he never misses his morning tea with his wife. Since both their schedules are rather full, this morning ritual is even more precious.
What makes him so motivated? Because I think he has a very busy schedule.
Yeah.
So, you know, would you like to say something about that?
I think his work keeps him motivated. Mm-hmm. His work, his ambition to teach students,
right.
and his talks. So, and that's more, he keeps on giving these talks and that keeps him more motivated. It's like, if I think maybe sometimes I tell him, do relax, but if he, suppose he relaxes and he doesn't like teach anybody for a week or 10 days, I think he'll just feel depressed.
Oh, okay.
Because his teaching, his work, that keeps him motivated and keeps going.
A typical Thursday usually starts with clinical meetings where they discuss recent advances in endocrinology and the research projects they're currently working on.
Okay, so what was the agenda of your academic meeting?
So it's a wide-reaching agenda. We have one seminar.
Yeah.
And today we were discussing endocrine aspects of transgenders.
Okay.
How to manage, as you know, that's a big issue these days. Mm. And we're getting a lot of referrals and opinion seekers for that. So our main focus today in the seminar was transgenders.
Okay.
We'll go for a detailed round. I will just take a brief round because I have to go to defense college right away to run a clinic.
All right. Yeah? So let's head there.
Yes.
The meeting is followed by rounds with his team where he checks on his inpatient cases.
What's our plan if we don't find the tumor?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that is the question. Next step.
Selective calcium stimulator.
Yeah, poor guy, we need to sort it out. He's been everywhere. Yeah. That should be controlled. We can do a calcium stimulation in that.
Mm-hmm.
Selective arterial.
Selective arterial calcium.
We've done that in the past with good results.
Mm-hmm.
In patients who were not diagnosed elsewhere,
yeah.
This technique really helped. So I think we should work on that.
So doctor, how often do you come across such cases and how would you...
He's not a common patient. He's an unusual patient.
Okay.
This is a condition that endocrinologists are supposed to deal with, and this is it's a hardcore endocrine problem.
Huh?
So these are patients who are you hear of diabetes all the time, high blood glucose.
Yeah.
These are patients who are getting spontaneous drops in blood glucose.
Okay.
And serious drops, like below 40, below 35. So one can become unconscious, and one can go into coma. There can be many causes for this, but the one that is always looked for is excess insulin in the body. So if we have to first prove low glucose, then we have to prove excess insulin. And then we have to show where it's coming from.
Okay.
Dr. Mithal spared some time to talk about his motivation to become an endocrinologist.
After I did my MBBS and MD, the idea was to specialize at a higher level. The obvious specialty those days was cardiology. Even now, it's a very popular specialty. But everyone wanted to do cardiology. So I think the search for trying to do something different led me to endocrinology, which was not even an established specialty at that time. And in fact, when I joined AIIMS, I joined as a research fellow in 1984 because there was no DM program in endocrinology. It's only in 85 that the DM program in endocrinology at AIIMS started. So actually we were among the earliest people to qualify. Other places had programs earlier, but not the Olney Institute.
Vitamin D deficiency is a growing public health challenge in India. Presently, he is leading the initiative to fortify edible oil and milk with vitamin D to help tackle this epidemic. Let's hear his thoughts on this issue.
So, you know, when I was in Sanjay Gandhi PGI, Lucknow, there were villages close by from which we used to get children whose bones were deformed. Right. Now, when I investigated that further, we found it was due to excess fluoride in drinking water. Mm-hmm. And that led us to study endemic fluorosis in great detail with modern techniques using modern metabolic parameters. That developed my interest in bone health in general, and subsequently set up India's first bone density program when I was at SGPGI. Especially urban office going Indians, our initial studies were all on doctors, so they are a very sort of set segment. They have low vitamin D because we don't go in the sun, despite there being my sunlight exposure today is zero, right? When we go in the sun, we rush away from it because we are scared of skin darkening. Either it's too hot or we are scared of skin darkening. Nowadays, people go in the sun, they apply, sunscreens. So that also doesn't allow vitamin D synthesis. When we go in the sun, we cover ourselves well culturally and otherwise. So even if people are in the sun, only the face is exposed sometimes. So there are multiple reasons why there is D deficiency in urban Indians. It's also there in rural, but it's less. It's more in the women than in the men in rural areas. So when we are looking to combat vitamin D deficiency or overcome D deficiency, the first thing that occurs to us is get it from the food. But there is no vitamin D in food. So therefore, what does the world do? They add vitamin D to a variety of things, especially milk. Milk has calcium, add vitamin D, great cocktail for the bones, right? The government has finally set the standards in 2016 for fortifying milk with vitamin D. And lots of dairies are already doing it now. And I expect in the next 3 years, most of the packaged commercially available milk that you will find will be vitamin D fortified. So that will not take away the problem completely, but it will raise, because fortification is with very small amounts always because of safety reasons, but it will attenuate the problem.
Most of his day is spent treating patients in OPD at two different locations, one being at Medanta Medicity in Gurgaon and the other at Defence Colony.
Whatever surgery has done, it's been a good sort of surgical result, but it's not gone. Little by now, I would have hoped that, you know, with the sharp decline and then... But with that sharp decline, jahan bhi pahunche wahi pe, it's not going down below that.
Diabetes is a lifestyle illness. And being an educator himself, Dr. Mithal understands the immense value of having trained diabetes educators as a part of his team.
Now that you have a team of 13, 14 diabetes educators with you, what is the difference that you see now and then?
So I really think, and you know that as well as I do, that diabetes care can only be advanced anywhere, but particularly in this country, with the help of diabetes educators. Doctors have only a fixed amount of time per patient. They don't have the time to really get into patients' personal issues, help them open up. Doctors are not even sometimes that well trained in nutrition. So I firmly believe that for providing better care, for every busy doctor, you need at least two or three good diabetes educators who are well trained, not only in diets, but also in insulin, low blood sugars, managing medication. I think advancing quality of care and delivery of care can only happen if we involve more and more educators and make a solid team.
His day is still not over. It's 8:30 p.m. and we are here at Gurgaon, where Dr. Mithal is conducting a CME on treatment modalities in type 2 diabetes.
It will be of great benefit without leading to the side effects sometimes that happen with the full dose of one drug.
So Dr. Mithal, you treat so many patients in a day. It takes a lot of dedication and a lot of energy. So what makes it worthwhile for you?
I think what keeps a doctor going really is a satisfaction of treating a patient well and the gratitude you get in return. Quite clearly, at a single point, that is what drives doctors, at least drives me, to carry on day after day like this.
Yeah. So doctor, entire team of Docplexus would like to thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.